Well, good morning, friends. Hey, it's Brother Mike again, back on the Sunday Morning Podcast. Thank you for tuning in. It's 9 a.m. Pacific time, and we're glad to have you here, for sure. This is Assassinate Trump Week. A week and a half or so ago, I think it was, or maybe a week ago, or just a few days ago, I was talking to my wife, and I said to her, you know, they haven't been able to get Trump thrown in jail. The polls never turned around, and President Biden's having some issues with dementia. I said, they're out of options. The only option they've got left is to assassinate him. And sure enough, a couple of days later, some 20-year-old kid with an AK something took a shot at him at a rally in Pennsylvania. So, fortunately, he turned his head and he missed, but that really wasn't that kid doing that. Yeah, far from it. That was Satan. He did that. He is a cold-blooded killer. Cold-blooded killer. He's responsible for all the deaths throughout human history. You know, they estimate that over 40 billion people have lived and died on the planet Earth since Noah. Again, that's an estimate. And it's going to get much worse during the tribulation. So we've got to be sober and vigilant, for our adversary, the devil, goes around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Don't forget about our services at the Arizona Deliverance Center. We're on 15th Avenue, just south of Osborn Road. It's a red brick building. We have Thursday and Friday night healing and deliverance and teaching services. It's 7 o'clock, Arizona and Pacific time. Broadcast live on our YouTube channel, youtube.com/houseofhealingAC. Mike@hardcorechristianity.com is my email. You can call me at 602-636-5800. Please remember, we have a counseling center available for born-again Christians. If you need counseling, you have no money, you can simply call, and I'll put you on the counseling schedule, and there is no charge. 602-636-5800. Normally, my podcasts are put on my Facebook page, but I've been on Facebook prison for a month. Apparently, they did not like one of my podcasts and decided to censor me for a month, but I get off of it in a couple of days. So hopefully my Sunday morning podcast will be broadcast there after I get out of Facebook jail. And that's something. Hey, I wanted to share something really interesting with you today. At least I think it is. I wanted to help you if you're the type of person, I say if you are, if you're the type of person that's a God seeker, you're hunting for God, you want the anointing, you want your destiny, you want your call. You want something similar to that, here's how you can get it. I'm going to show you exactly what to do. How are you going to do that, Brother Mike? I'm going to read from the Word of God and show you exactly what you're supposed to do. Luke chapter 5. It came to pass, as the people pressed upon Jesus to hear the Word of God. Now, that's something that you rarely see in the United States. People don't press in to hear the Word of God. They just kind of casually go in, sit in the church, listen to the Word of God, say hi a few times, ship out a couple of God bless yous, and head for Kentucky Fried Chicken. But these people were pressing in to hear the Word of God. Jesus was standing by the lake, and he saw two ships by the lake, but the fishermen were gone. They were washing their nets. They had finished for the day. And it's very common for fishermen to work the night shift back then. They would fish all night, and then in the morning they would clean their nets, and then they would go home, be with their families, and rest. Since the boats were empty and the nets were out of them, they were cleaning them, Jesus got into one of the ships because they were pressing on him. The mobs were coming at him like, wouldn't believe, crowd control, and he used the water in the ship as crowd control. And the ship he happened to go into wasn't by chance. It was the Holy Spirit telling him. It was Simon Peter's ship. Now, Simon was a very wealthy Jew back in the day. His dad had started a fishing business when he was a kid. He grew up in his dad's fishing business. When his dad died, he inherited the business. And they had several ships, and they had it was big money. Peter was, to use a slang term, loaded. And it says Jesus prayed with him that he would thrust out a little from the land, and Jesus sat down in the ship, and he taught the people out of the ship. Brilliant. He used the water as a megaphone, as an amplifier, and he wasn't getting mobbed or mugged, so it worked out perfectly. And then when Jesus finished up his teaching, he said to Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch. Agra is the Greek word where we get our English word agriculture. It means to bring in a haul of something. Could be fish, could be crops, could be whatever. Agra is the Greek word. Drop down your nets over there. What was Jesus doing? I'm not sure, but it was a nice gesture, wasn't it? Peter let him use the ship so he could preach the word. And then Jesus then turned around and used the word to illustrate how the word generates miracles. See, the word of God, if you believe it, generates miracles. If you have any doubt at all, that wipes out the word. You remember what Jesus said in Mark? If you have faith and not doubt not, you shall not only do that which is done unto the fig tree, but also if you say unto this mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea, it shall be done. And all things whatsoever you desire, when you pray, believe that you receive them, and you will have them. The key to that verse, believe it or not, that I just quoted in Mark, what is that, chapter 11? Is, and doubt not. Here's how it works. Go to my YouTube page and get the teaching on pistis. It was the number one revelation God ever gave me. Pistis, faith. If you follow that Bible study, you'll understand exactly what faith is all about, why it works, and why faith doesn't work. Pistis in Greek is the Greek word for faith, and it means to believe with no doubt and no unbelief. Zero, zero. If you filter in doubt and unbelief with your faith, it wipes out the faith. The faith doesn't wipe the doubt out. To fix your faith, you must remove the doubt first, then increase your faith with the word. That's how people like Sister Etter and Smith Wigglesworth existed on this planet. They removed the doubt, and then they increased their faith through God's holy word. That's how it's done. You cannot increase your faith through the word of God and keep doubt. It won't work. And pastors and ministers and teachers don't understand that. They can't figure out why Christianity doesn't work. They keep telling them, read your Bible more, study the Bible, go to Sunday school, go to church, and it doesn't work. Here's why it doesn't work. They didn't read the verse. If you have faith and doubt not, you have to remove the doubt first, then increase your faith. That's how it works. Back to our incredible story. Simon says to him, using his logical mind, because Simon's an expert. He had inherited his dad's fishing business, and he was making real money there. He was literally an expert in that field. He had grown up in it as a kid. And he knew the facts, and here are the facts. He says to a master, he calls him master, which is a red flag that Peter had great respect for him after hearing that teaching, whatever it was, on that boat. Epistates, commander, is what that Greek word means. He's the commander, the big boss, the big cheese. That's the term you would use to describe a mafia boss or a president of a corporation. The commander. He said, commander, we have toiled all night. See, they worked at night cleaned nets in the mornings, and then spent the day on other things and with their families. We toiled all night, and we have taken nothing, it says, verse 5. Nevertheless, again, Peter heard God's word like he'd never heard it before, and he had deep respect for it. So when the commander said, let out your nets for a catch, even though all night long you've caught nothing, Peter said, nevertheless, at your word, rhema word. Jesus gave him a rhema word. Previously, Jesus, when he was on the boat teaching, had given them a logos word. He had given them a complete teaching, the logos, but rhema is a part of the logos. The logos is the pizza. Rhema is a piece of the pizza. Now he gives them a piece of the pizza. Drop your nets off on the other side for a catch. Nevertheless, at the rhema word, I will let down the net. So remember, they had just cleaned the nets. He didn't want to let down the nets. The nets were clean, and they were supposed to be used that night again. But because he obeyed, and he was so impressed with God's word that he obeyed without questioning, boop, he drops the nets. And when they had done this, it says, verse 6, a great multitude of fish filled the net. And there were so many fish, these powerful nets started to break. Now, that was the first time in Peter's career that had ever happened. He'd never seen anything like it before. He grew up in the business, and he was absolutely flabbergasted. Remember, he had previously heard the word, then saw the miracle of the word. That's how the process works. You believe the word, and if you truly believe it, removing the doubt, the miracle follows. Verse 7. Peter started to yell at the other fishermen. They were already off duty. They'd worked all night. They were exhausted. But this massive haul of fish, Peter starts to yell at his other partners and employees. He starts yelling at them. Come on over here. Hey, you're not going to believe this. You're not going to believe it. And there were so many fish, it says they filled both ships. Now, see, this is what happens to the word of God when doubt is removed. But if you leave doubt in with the word fails. When the Bible says that my word shall not return void, it's talking about the pure, unadulterated word of God with doubt removed. The word of God that goes out mixed with doubt does not returns void. It does not return with value. It doesn't work. Remember that. Remember those words in Mark 11, and doubt not. You must repent over doubt and unbelief and remove it so your faith can bloom. That's how that people like Sister Kuhlman, Sister Etter, Sister McPherson, Sis Wigglesworth, the great John Lake. That's how these people materialized, okay? They don't grow on trees. They all went through the exact same process. Faith and doubt. Remove the doubt first, then your faith will boom. They fill both these ships full of fish. First time in Peter's life he'd ever seen anything like that. Two things happened to Peter that day that was he had never seen before. He heard the true, unadulterated word of God and saw the miracle that follows believing God's word. Two things in one day changed his life till the day he died. Verse 8. Have you ever wondered what you need to do to get the anointing, your call, and your giftings? Have you ever wondered why you don't have them? You'll wonder no more after today. Verse 8, when Simon Peter saw, when he saw He fell down at Jesus' feet. He fell down at Jesus' knees, it says. So it sounds like he fell on his knees and he was looking up at him down by Jesus' knees. Or it says falling down. Prosipto in Greek usually means to fall prostrate, flat. So it looks like Peter ran up to him, fell flat on his face underneath Jesus' knees, down at his feet. That's what this looks like. And he says to the Lord, listen to this. The ticket to miracles is right here. Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. He called him commander earlier. Now he calls him Kurios, Lord, the one with supreme authority, Lord. It says in verse 9, for he was astonished, and everyone with him, at the draw of fish they took. Can you imagine that? Wow. Folks, I just handed you the key. You've got the card. You know, you put the card in, you get into a hotel room, click, click. I just handed you the card. Now, remind you, Peter was a very sinful man. He admitted it. In addition to that, the guy was a loudmouth jerk. Peter had flaws coming out of his ears. That's why I liked the guy so much. He had flaws everywhere. God knew he had flaws. The Holy Ghost picked him out and said, hey, this screwed up, jacked up guy is going to preach on the day of Pentecost. He got the first revelation of the Lord Jesus, didn't he? He said, you are the Christos, you are the Christ, you are the Moshiach, the Messiah, the Son of the living God. He was the first one that got that revelation. Nobody else ever had it until he got it. What's the point here? Are you a certified goof? You got a card that says, I'm a goof. Good. Good. Peter had the same card. Yeah, he had ID. I'm an idiot. But God knew he was an idiot, but also knew of his potential. If you are an imbecile, an idiot, a kook, a moron, congratulations. God is able to look past that and see what you could be, what you could become. Peter was chosen, flaws and all, to be the preacher at Pentecost. The preacher at Pentecost. That's your call. You are to be called by God to be a preacher at Pentecost. Not that one 2,000 years ago, of course, but some new Pentecost. Coordinated, directed, ministered by you. And if you think you got flaws and you can't be chosen, you're not going to think that anymore, because Peter had flaws and he was chosen. But, verse 8 is your ticket to miracles. When Simon Peter saw, he fell down prostrate at Jesus' knees, saying, depart from me, O Lord, I am a sinful man. Listen to me carefully. You can just have this quote. You know I do a lot of quotes, right? You can have this one. The closer you get to God, the more you will abhor yourself. well, that's kind of depressing. No, it isn't. That's the best thing in the world. The closer you get to God, the less satisfied you are with you. And that's what happened to Peter. But because he confessed it and because he surrendered, guess what happened? Guess what happened? Yeah. Verse 19. Everybody was stunned. James, John, Simon, and Jesus said to them, he said to Peter, "Fear not. From now on, you won't be catching fishes. You will be catching men." When they brought the ships to land, they left their careers behind and followed him. James, Peter, John. Those three guys, listen to this, those three guys were Jesus' inner circle among the 12 disciples. He had the 12 disciples, and those were his inner circle. The inner sanctum was James, Peter, and John. And he met them all in one day, and they all had the same careers. They all fished for a living. Now, I'm not sure if John and James were partners of Peter. They could have been a partnership business. But anyway, they were all together in this fishing business, and they all left it the same day. God's calling you, friend, to leave your old business behind, whatever it is. Whatever the devil sucked you into, your sickness, your mental illness, your oppression of spirits, whatever you got, your bad attitudes, your anger, your temper, your offenses, whatever it is, God wants you to leave it behind. Let it go and remove it. He wants to leave your fishing business behind. But before you do that, you got to do something. Boom. You got to fall down at Jesus' feet. And you got to confess it. "Depart from me, O Lord. I am a sinful man." Always remember, the closer you get to God, the less you will like yourself. Your ministry, your career, your calling, your anointing isn't based on yourself. And you've got to get rid of yourself and adopt your new identity and your new nature in Christ. I taught on it Friday night, Romans chapter 12. Taught on it extensively. Recommend you check out that study, youtube.com/houseofhealingaz. You must leave your life behind. You must leave your fishing business behind. You must leave your life behind. It says they all three left and formed the inner sanctum. Okay, the 12 disciples, that was the in group. Looks like I lost my feed there, and I apologize for that. Those three got to go everywhere with Jesus. That's what you're going to do. You're going to leave your old life behind, and you're going to let your fishing business go. It stinks anyway. Fishing business stinks. You're going to leave the scent of sin behind. It stinks too. You're going to go into the inner sanctum. As Paul said in Hebrews, having boldness, therefore, let us come boldly before the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Are you a failure? Have you got flaws? Are you got personality problems? You got personality deficits? Wow. Well, here's what you need. You need the Logos, then you need a Rhema word. And you know what you'll get then if you believe it? by removing doubt. You got to remove the doubt first. You're going to get a miracle you can't even believe. Super abundance comes to you. The nets weren't full, they were breaking. The boats didn't have a lot of fish in them. They were overflowing with fish. They were losing as many fish as they were saving. The nets broke and the fish were falling out and swimming away. The boats were filled, they were coming over the sides. That's what happens when you remove your doubt and you truly believe. If you have faith and doubt not, you will not only do that which is done to the fig tree, but also if you say to this mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast in the sea, it shall be done. And remember, all things you desire in prayer, believing, you shall receive if you remove the doubt first. If you're a pastor or a minister, stop teaching people false doctrines. Here's what I mean. Pastor so-and-so, teacher so-and-so, I'm having trouble believing God. I don't know what to do. Oh, I do. Read the word more. Get up an hour early, do this and that. Read the word more. Stop teaching a false doctrine. That's a false doctrine. Reading the word's not going to help. First, remove the doubt. Remove the doubt first. Then do what your pastor told you. Read the word of God and allow it to flourish. If you read the word of God through clear eyes, meaning you have no doubt, the word of God never returns void. If you read the word of God through clouded eyes of unbelief, doubt, the word of God returns a failure. It doesn't work. How can I accomplish it? Well, follow Peter. One, he confessed it. Two, he falls down at his knees, prostrate on the ground. Down. Depart from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man. And right after that, Jesus said, you're going to be fishing for men. Notice there was no condemnation there. Jesus didn't sit him down for a Brother Mike counseling session, did he? No. Now, Peter, let me talk to you a little bit. You've got a lot of flaws. You've got a big mouth. You run your mouth like a busted chainsaw. You say things you shouldn't. You're impulsive. You run your mouth before you think. No, he didn't go over any of those things with him. No, he saw Peter's potential. Peter saw himself as a sinful man and a failure. God saw him as a preacher at Pentecost. And you have a preaching assignment coming in some fashion or some form at Pentecost. Your Pentecost, not Peter's. He had his and that's over. You got one now, if you will follow Peter's example. Just follow the steps. You know, pretend you're Dorothy in the Wizard of Oz. Follow the Yellow Brick Road. Follow the Yellow Brick Road. See, that's what the Munchkins told her. Follow the Yellow Brick Road. What do you do? Follow the Logos. Take a rhema word. Follow the Logos. Follow Peter. Do what he did. God never even mentioned his flaws. He knew he was loaded with flaws. He knew that. When he called him, he knew it. The guy was a blooming imbecile. And God knew that before he called him. But God doesn't call you based on what you are. He calls you based on what you could become. And when the Holy Ghost is around, any person can become great in the eyes of God. Anybody, regardless of flaws, can become a preacher at Pentecost. What does preacher at Pentecost mean? It doesn't mean preaching at a Pentecost. It means you've got some special gifting and anointing and calling in it. You've got something there. There's something there hidden within you that needs to come out. God wants to bring it out. No question. You know what he wants you to do? He wants you to come boldly before the grace, before the throne of grace, that you may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Well, Brother Mike, Christianity doesn't work for me. I know it doesn't work because you're not listening to what I said. Here's faith, here's doubt. If you mix the two together, faith doesn't work. Jesus specifically told you, Mark 11, I think it is, if you have faith and doubt not, and doubt not, okay? In that verse, the Greek word kai is used for and. That's a conjunction. That means this part of the verse is connected to this part. When you see a conjunction in the middle of a verse, it means like a plus sign. These two parts of the verse are together. If you have faith and doubt not, distazo is the Greek word. It means to vacillate between one position or the other. What do you want to eat for breakfast, Bob? Oh, shoot. Let me think about it. I think I'll take... I have an eggs. No, I want pancakes. No, I want a waffle. No, let me think. Gosh, you know what? I don't even know what to do. Bring me a bowl of strychnine. You're vacillating back and forth between subjects. Distazo, doubting. If you have faith and doubt not. How do you fix it? It's not the way the minister or pastor said. They're wrong. They don't understand the word. You have to remove the doubt first. Cancer serves. You got to remove the doubt, that's the tumor, so that your body can flourish, so your faith can grow. Yes, if you have faith and doubt not, you will become a preacher at Pentecost. That's what God's calling you for, and that's what you're going to do. I love you, and I'll see you next time.